Welcome to this podcast. It's making me thirsty, the number one destination for Seinfeld fans. This episode 121. Today's guest is a veteran sports radio host and journalist with Fox Sports, MLB.com, and SI.com. He was a major part of the Dan Patrick Show for 12 years. He currently hosts the Maggie and Perloff Show every weekday from 3 to 6 on CBS Sports Radio and Television and Sirius XM. He can be seen in several Adam Sandler films, including the recently released and highly praised Hustle, which is on Netflix now. And of course, he's a huge Seinfeld fan. Please welcome Andrew Perloff. Andrew, thanks for joining.
My pleasure. Yeah, that's that resume sounds better than it actually was in real life, by the way. Although the Dan Patrick part was really fun. The SI.com, FoxSports.com, that's a long time ago.
But you've made so many connections through those SI.com days, obviously with Maggie and Jimmy Traina, et cetera. So it's we're honored to have a movie star on the program today. But Andrew, to take us back, we were talked off air a little bit. You're Philly, graduated Dartmouth in 93. Yep. That's kind of peak Seinfeld, right? Season five. We always like to get a little history on when our guests first kind of fell in love with the show. Were you watching it in college during, those 89 to 93 years, or when did you kind of pick it up?
I went to college in Hanover, New Hampshire, and we had like just bare bones cable. So I think we got NBC. We didn't get Fox. That's like in 92, 93, you didn't get Fox. So we had tapes of The Simpsons. And I remember I came home to Philadelphia. Two friends, Jeremy Carver and Ronnie Carmi, had tapes of Seinfeld. In the first season, I was in college. And I remember he's like, you got to watch this show. I'm like, oh, Seinfeld, like, it's not doing that well, right? And he's like, no, you got to watch it. So we sat and watched basically most of the first season, maybe four or five episodes. Both those guys went on to be comedy writers in Hollywood. Like, they knew exactly what they were talking about. They worshiped the show. So I saw it on tape spring break for the first time.
Wow. So that was like when you were a freshman?
No, I think I was a freshman. So what was the first year of the show?
The first season was 89.
Yeah, but 90 really. I mean, the summer of 90 is when the first episodes hit, the summer of 90.
Yeah, I was definitely late. I was definitely late to the show. But I think, I mean, honestly, like, as I remember it, everybody was, though. Like, it was a thing for a little while.
For the most part, yeah. Do you remember of those episodes, or maybe even when you just started kind of then getting into it yourself, what was the episode that sort of clicked? Like, what was the episode that sort of clicked for you?
It's probably a total cliche, but the Chinese restaurant was the one. Okay. The one that I remember the most. Maybe because the format was so novel. Also, you got to remember, too. So I graduated college and moved to New York. And that was my life. I mean, New York was my life. Like, the New York that Seinfeld is describing was my New York. I moved to the Upper East Side. It was the only place I could afford to live. Waited at Chinese restaurants. Like, so that one is the one that I remember really resonating. Now, I don't know for sure that's the first one that I loved, but when I think back to that question, that's my answer.
Yeah, that makes sense. I mean, that was a groundbreaking one. You know what I love about the Chinese restaurant, by the way? Like, everyone remembers it as like it's all in one spot and it's the whole thing and everything. George tells a story about having to go to the bathroom in the girl's apartment and it's too small of an apartment and like he has to get out of there. Like, that's your introduction to George almost in that episode. It's so classic George, you know?
Like I said, that was my life.
Right.
I mean, dating and size of apartment and bathrooms. I tell this story actually on my show. There was one when it was so hard to get an apartment. I went to an apartment and the bathroom was like right in the middle of the living room with no separation, no door around it. Like, that would happen in New York City. And I always thought, like, well, what if I'm on a date and I come home and like we go to the bedroom area? I'm like, excuse me, I have to go to the bathroom right here with no door. That would have been a great Seinfeld moment. So I totally relate to that.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like we've all kind of experienced that in those kind of New York City apartments. It was funny you mentioned the Chinese restaurant. Your old coworker, Peter King, we talked with Mike Florio, and he mentions Peter King. All he does is yell out Cartwright all the time. Did he do that when you were working with him?
You know, Mike was in the studio with Peter. I never spent that kind of time with Peter. I edited Peter. That was one of my first jobs at SI. And I love Peter. He's unbelievable what he does. But I don't remember. Yeah, I do remember him totally falling in love with Seinfeld. I don't remember him yelling that, but that does sound like him.
Who else? So yeah, we have talked to a lot of your colleagues in radio, especially sports radio. It's kind of right up our alley, if you will, for a marine biologist reference. But who else are you? I mean, we mentioned Jimmy Trainor. We had him on early on in our podcast. But like, I know Maggie's a big Seinfeld fan as well. But like, even with the Dan Patrick Show, like, how often is it coming up in conversations? Yeah. How often are you guys like trying to weave it into an episode of one of your own shows and things like that?
It's a great question. Think about Dan Patrick. When Dan was owning the world at SportsCenter, his schedule, and he's told me about this many times, he loves Seinfeld. He thinks it's a great show. He didn't watch it in the 90s. He was sitting in SportsCenter on Thursday night watching hockey games or writing the show. He missed the entire phenomenon. So he never weaves the stories in. And he appreciates it. As I told you guys before, we had Seinfeld on the show at the Super Bowl once. We had Larry David on. But Dan could not watch it live because he was busy working. You know, and it's like, those are sort of two North Stars of the TV world, SportsCenter at night. But if you think about it, there's no way you could watch it. And we didn't have DVRs. So you could exchange tapes. Like, I know Rich Eisen, for example, loves it and quotes it all the time, who I've worked with a lot. But Dan is not that guy at all. Like, and me and the producers of the show all knew it really well, but Dan never got into it much.
But he's interviewed, so, like you said, you mentioned Larry, you mentioned Jerry, and I feel like there's been a ton of, like, like Cranston have been on the program.
Yeah.
It's probably a thrill for you being a Seinfeld fan. Tell us a little bit about, we saw the interview obviously with Jerry and him analyzing the skit you guys did.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about that. I mean, did you kind of get to talk to him pre or post have any sort of relationship with him at all? From that?
I wouldn't call it a relationship. I don't remember what Jerry was doing around that. It might've been like the B movie or something, but so he was in New York Super Bowl. He was very nice, very polite. But I remember, you probably saw in the clip, he was very judgmental in almost a funny way of our attempts at being funny. Because we all think we're funny. We're all like the funny guys in our crew of friends. Try to be funny in front of Jerry Seinfeld, and it's a very humbling experience. So it kind of like, I guess it kind of came off as a little cocky or arrogant, but like, it's like calling Michael Jordan cocky or arrogant. It didn't come off in any kind of a brace way. He could not have been more polite to everybody on set. But he's like, you guys, like, you're funny, don't you? And like, he was like sort of making fun of us, but in a way that didn't make us feel bad. So it was really great. It was one of my favorite guests of all time on Dan Patrick Show, just because he was just so confident that he was a master of humor and we were not. And we walked away and said, yep, you're right, Jerry. You're absolutely right. And, but you can tell a lot. You probably guys have seen some of it too. Like, you tell a lot from the 5 minutes before they get there, how they deal with the sound guy, the makeup guy, and what they're like afterwards. Like, anyone could get on air with Dan, who's like the king, and like amp it up and be a good guy. It's just, you know, we kind of judge guys a little bit by how they are to everybody else. And he could not have been nicer. And also, I mean, like, but he was cocky. And you might be asking me next, but Larry David was on. Larry had a totally different vibe. Larry was on because Carissa Thompson was guest hosting for Dan in Los Angeles. And Carissa and Larry are famously friends. Like, she tweets about it a lot. And he came on and he has a totally different vibe than Jerry. He wasn't, he came in and he saw our set and immediately started doing a Larry David tour around the set. Like, what's the deal with this thing? What's that doing there? And he immediately got in since it was a sports show. Broke into a 3-minute diatribe on what the Jets needed to do, got into X and O's. And he was much, much different than Jerry. Jerry was a little more, carrying himself like a bigger star. Larry, for some reason, felt a little more like just one of the guys. I don't know. I'm not sure if you had that experience talking to other people.
Yeah, I feel like, I mean, just to break it down simply, like, Larry lives like he has house money. Jerry feel like maybe the weight of the world's on him a little more and he has to prove himself and prove out like, oh, that's funny. That's not Larry just doesn't care.
No. Yeah. I think it's a little unfair to Jerry too, because that is true. They carry themselves differently. Larry definitely, like, I don't know if it was a confidence or just did not care at all. Yeah, that's a great way to describe it. Like, he didn't put on like, I didn't get the sense that Larry cared what anybody thought about him, where Seinfeld probably did want to be like demand this certain amount of respect.
Interesting. You know, that comes across, I think, when you see them on interviews, but hearing it like kind of firsthand really, makes sense. And those are two great stories. Obviously we mentioned at the top, Sandler, another icon. As you're talking about Jerry, you're talking about Larry, we'd be remiss if we didn't kind of talk about Sandler a little bit and just what his vibe is like. He's running that whole show, right? I mean, he's producing those movies, oftentimes probably writing them or at least involved heavily. So I'm sure there's a lot going on, but how is he? We have talked to a few people who have worked with him, but not probably, I know you've worked on a couple of his things. And so where does he land in the vibe department as far as that goes?
Curious. So Adam, Dan has been in 22 Adam Sandler movies or something crazy like that. He's very good friends with Dan. He is, of all the actors we've interviewed and all the guest stars we have, he's the most down to earth of every single one of them. And he is so nice to all of us. So the first one we were in was That's My Boy with Andy Samberg. And he took us up to Boston and we shot for a full day. And he couldn't have been we're nobodies. And he ingratiated us in the set. Like, let us sit with the director, and he could not have been nicer. And he's taken us out to dinner multiple times, probably three times. He took the producers and Dan out to dinner. We were on this movie Pixels in Toronto. He took us to dinner with Dan Aykroyd and Ivan Reitman's restaurant. And we were sitting with Sandler and Dan Aykroyd, and Ivan Reitman came by. And Sandler, dude, this is Sandler. I don't know how much you know the Dan Patrick show. Fritzy is a guy in the show, and he'll ask you anything or say anything. And Sandler and Adam, Todd goes to Sir Adam, can I ask him about the 70s skits on Saturday Night Live? And Sandler's like, hey, Danny, Todd wants to know about the Saturday Night Live in the 70s. And Dan's like, ask away. I'm like, he's just like, he's like, to him, everybody's the same. It's weird. He is, I don't know what. I'm sure when in the middle of production, he can be tough, but he is so nice. And so I went out for Hustle in Philadelphia last fall. And this one was weird because Dan wasn't with me. It was just me. Adam and Dan sort of hooked me up because the movie's set in Philadelphia and I'm a Sixers fan. So they're like, all right, let's get Andrew a line in this one. So I was there alone and I didn't see Adam the whole time. He was filming in another part of the city. Then he came over and we shot our scene, but he couldn't have been nicer. The funny thing, by the way, and I might have told you guys this. So I was practicing the line. I had one line. I was practicing with Dan and the crew all day long. And somebody said, oh, this is exactly these pretzels are making me thirsty with Kramer.
Yeah.
So my line became, people were saying that, oh, this is these pretzels are making me thirsty. So I kept on walking around and I'd be like, I can't say the line because it gives up a plot point. It's a total spoiler. I'm sorry, but I would basically say it 100 times. And
For those who haven't seen it, it's a great flick. It's kind of like a Rocky type, a Philly tie, but kind of inspirational. And you're like Tom Brokaw, the reporter, getting in there, doing your thing.
More of a print reporter. So I have to ask a question that moves the plot along of Juancho Hernan Gomez, who's the star. And it was great. We shot it 22 times because they shot. I said the line, we got to get this angle. We got to get this angle. And there were 500 extras on the street. Movie making is insane, especially on the road. So it was a wonderful
experience. Was Dan Patrick in it before that? Okay.
Yeah. We shot him on his set.
Yeah,
all
right. The timing was perfect because I was I was looking for you, and all of a sudden they showed Dan Patrick, and then boom, it was coincidence, but I work with him and everything. But
yeah, so funny story. That was on purpose, actually. Yeah.
Oh, all right. Well, there you go. Funny story. We had the writers of, if you remember the episode, The Junior Mint, the famous episode. Andy Robin, the writer, he used to work for Saturday Night Live, and story has it, he said, I guess it was back in 92 or so when Jerry was hosting Saturday Night Live. Andy brought the script for the Junior Mint. He asked Sandler to give it to Jerry. So Sandler took it, made the connection, and kind of the rest is history. So it's kind of cool little cool little nugget story. That Sandler had an impact on Seinfeld, believe it or not.
I love, I'll admit, I'm a junkie of any Saturday Live podcast if a Saturday Live person's on a podcast, they talk about the behind the scenes connections. I love that because obviously, like Seinfeld, I'm a huge SNL fan. So that I love stories like that. And I know Jerry Seinfeld too. Didn't half the guys do a Jerry Seinfeld impersonation to make it on the show? I think that was like Jimmy Fallon famously. I think I heard recently Sandberg or somebody was doing Jerry Seinfeld, in his tryout with Lorne, but there's definitely a lot of ties there.
Yeah, that makes sense. I mean, that definitely makes sense. That's hilarious. Sandler, the Sandler SNL connection there we got from Andy Robin was great. So, Howard just mentioned the Junior Mint, obviously a classic with, that's Mulva, right? The Junior Mint, Dolores Mulva. But so let's get into it a little bit. We talked about when you got into the show Seinfeld, but, as you've now probably watched a million reruns and kind of dove into the show a bit more after college. Where do you sit on sort of your favorite seasons? I guess we tend to lean towards the earlier years. Two through five, six is good and solid, but after seven and I, David leaves, it gets a little bit crazy. Those later years, eight and nine, it, for us, it gets a little bit too cartoonish. Just curious, where do you land? What are some of your go-to episodes and what seasons kind of stick out to you?
Well, I think, first of all, I think my experience of the show is different than your guys, because I think I'm older than you. Yeah. We were so excited for Thursday night for the show. So I've seen a million reruns, but to me, the liveness and the freshness of it, there'd be an episode like the Hamptons or something. Then Monday at work, everybody'd be talking about the Hamptons. But I actually thought of a couple of my favorite episodes and my favorite moments. And I'm sure you guys have heard these ones all the time, but I can tell you, I know my favorite episode. It's definitely when George Does the Opposite spoke to me in such a deep way, because I felt like at that part of my life, if I had just done the opposite of everything Andrew Perloff wanted to do, I would have been successful. And I think to me, that was really close to the utter peak of the show. I think it was close to the peak of the cultural phenomenon that it was. I don't know what season that was. You guys know?
Five.
Yeah. Is that considered critically one of the best seasons? Or
probably the best season. And I've said this many times. I said I feel like the series could have ended on that episode, and I would have been happy. Ended to your point, the peak, and that was it. That was perfection in my mind. Yeah.
I think the funniest line ever, and unfortunately they brought it back in the finale and didn't work as well. The funniest line to me was Jerry Stiller. When he learns that George dies and he says to Steinbrenner, Jay Buhner, to me, that might be the hardest I've ever laughed.
That's my favorite line of all time.
I feel like the whole series led up to that very moment. Jay Buhner. And as a huge sports fan, I related so much to that scene. And then they brought it back with Hideki Arabu in the finale or something, which is so funny. Yeah. But it wasn't. Just the fact that was that's probably my favorite line.
I go to that all the time. I mean, speaking of not only sports fan, I'm a New York Yankees sports fan growing up. All I heard about was a Jay Buhner trade my whole life. And then they say it on TV. It totally just blew my mind. It was one of the greatest.
By the way, now that I'm in sports radio, I always George is an executive, and he says, I figured out a way to get Griffey, Bonds, and somebody else in right field. We don't give up anything. I would think of a trade proposal. I'd be like, it's just like when George wanted to get Griffey, Bonds, and somebody else and not give up anything. But you hear a lot of LA. I love that. I love, for some reason, I'm not a Yankees fan. I'm a Phillies fan, but the Yankees stuff was always funny. In the opposite scene, I think the most popular scene of the opposite one is when he's hitting, when he hits a home run with, was it Jeter and Bernie? You won, but you won in six games. That scene is amazing.
Yeah, the Yankee stuff is great. Sports in general, right? And I mean, I think for me, the show that kind of catapulted it was the Keith Hernandez episode. That was just a special episode.
The other thing we like to talk about, because obviously, our podcast really, really revolves around the guest stars, to be honest with you. It's who we've had on the most, is all these different guest stars, right? Jimmy's been on, and Jackie Childs, Mickey. So we love the guest stars. We think that the show, you know, obviously the core four is great, but we love these guest stars. You know, Bookman recently passed away yesterday. Yeah. So curious, like, you know, who are some of your favorite of those sort of those guest stars? You know, the parents, we like to keep the parents separate, you know, and Newman separate because they're kind of bigger. Yeah, yeah. Obviously we could talk about them too, but they're serious. Like who's your kind of go-to kind of, you know, guest star roles that you love?
I don't know why, because he's so annoying, but Banya, I find the relationship with Seinfeld and Banya is amazing. And the soup count, like I always remember that one. I don't know. I also felt like I knew that guy in some form or other. So that's one that jumps out. I was actually thinking about this before the show and I don't know if you've ever had this one. And I had to Google his names. I couldn't remember it. The guy who pirates videos. Do you guys know his name?
Brody.
Brody, yes. For some reason, that character always struck with me because he was so intense and so scary. And I don't know why. That guy always struck with me. Brody was a big deal. I liked him. I mean, there's so many. Obviously, does Susan count as a major character or not really? Because any plot around her always destroyed me. I always thought that was good. But that's too big, right?
No, that's a good one. I mean, because she's interesting with Susan a lot. Some people love her. Some people don't like her. It's a good one to bring up Susan because one of those like was it lightning rod kind of things? Like people don't like that she dies. Some people love that, you know, didn't mind that she died. Right. It's just a whole thing with Susan. But, I mean, the Cheever letter, you know, what's great. Sorry. Yeah. The two Susans that I love is the Rye when they're all, the parents meet each other and you know, who's having sex with the chicken. And I never, you know, what's Merlot, never heard of it. That whole scene. And then, the Cheever letters whole scene too is another one good with Susan.
Oh yeah. Yeah. But I think I like the way that George plays off her. You know, I'm a big fan of the little mini arc of the Summer of George. As we talk about this, like I'm definitely more relate to George. Just personally. So, anything really with him just kills me. And funny thing too is but I think I act a little more like Kramer and I look more and more like Kramer, but mentally, I'm more George. I think everybody kind of relates to George in some way, though, right? Like he's like the ultimate insecure male, don't you think?
Yeah, I mean, he's a show.
And I think we've spoken to a lot of writers, and I feel like George is the easiest to write for.
Yeah,
but then again, George himself, Chase Alexander, says in the later years when Larry David left, like no one really got him. He changed a little bit. If you know the later years where he's just like yelling and like doing stuff like that, you know, he's less of a loser. We love loser opposite George, or before the opposite, actually unemployed, living with his parents. Like, I think that's the George we could all relate to. I think, hey, you know, listen, there's a lot of people who love the later seasons.
I have a quick George story. I have a quick George story from my real life. So there was a guy, when I got out of college, I took a few creative writing classes of some sort at SVA in New York City, School of Visual Arts. And there was a writer named, I'm forgetting his last name. His name was Charlie. He wrote a couple episodes. And he is the one, he grew up in New York with Larry David, like they were friends. And he is the one who snubbed Larry David's ex-girlfriend. So he came up with the episode, The Snub. Now, actually, he did not get a writing credit for it. He was on staff.
Gail Cunningham.
This guy's name is Charlie. He did not get the writing credit for it. Yeah. Oh, okay.
Charlie Rubin, right? Charlie Rubin, right.
Yeah, yeah, you guys ever had him on? Or?
No, we did reach out to him, though. I believe he's at NYU now. He taught you at School of Visual Arts, you said?
You know what? It might have been NYU.
Yeah,
it was one of those two.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure he's at NYU now. Actually, I know because I emailed him at NYU and he snubbed us. He didn't get back to us.
But I was thinking, I heard recently on a podcast, and I apologize, I don't remember what it was, that Jason Alexander didn't really get the character of George. And then one day he said to Larry after like episode 5, you guys have probably heard this story, I don't want to do this. I don't think my character would react like that. And Larry goes, what do you mean you would react like that? That's exactly what I did. He goes, you did. He's like, yeah, that's what happened. And the fact that like, so Charlie cluing me into that, the snub actually happened was like, just like the, as outrageous as the Larry David stuff was, I think that that being rooted in reality is what I really related to. And, you know, Larry's, I think, a little older than me, but I knew a lot of those kind of people in New York. So I really, really kind of relate to the Larry stories, which I think the world later figured out in Curb Your Enthusiasm, sort of that mentality. But a lot of that stuff came through to me. So a lot of like weird George plots. You're right. Towards the end, he definitely was like angry George I didn't relate to, but insecure George I totally relate to.
Yeah, I think that's what we fell in love with. You mentioned like watching it live in those earlier seasons.
Yeah,
that's what we fell in love with watching it live was just how George, you know, was that wrong when he had sex with the cleaning woman and just like always doubling down on that stuff, right? But it's interesting you mentioned that because we've talked to a lot of writers and Larry and Jerry just wanted real stories. That was what they wanted. Yeah. So almost all these stories are here. Like we just found out, I don't know if you remember the episode where Jerry, the girl's talking dirty to Jerry and he says, the panties your mother laid out for you. And she's like the guy really said that. We talked to the writer the other day who actually said that to a woman. Like that's how that got it. Like things like that, you just think like, wow, it's true stories. You know, it's like that's the whole thing is, and that's why everyone relates to the show. Like even now, like it's still resonating with 20-year-olds today because, or 15-year-olds today, because that part never changes, even though pay phones aren't there anymore and answer machines aren't there anymore. Like the human connection that is in Seinfeld, like still stays with us all. So it's just great.
You remind me of a line I love too, by the way, when I can't remember the situation, but basically, the issue of a threesome comes up and you know, because I was like, I mean, 20 something guy, like you're always talking about that stuff. And then George says, basically couldn't do it because he'd have to wear a smoking jacket. I totally related to like that mindset of like wanting to be Hugh Hefner, but knowing deep down inside that there's no way that's going to happen. That, which reminds me of the talking dirty, one, which is amazing.
So Andrew, you're back to the Dan Patrick Show. You always had a common theme, against the grain, so give us a little like Seinfeld. What would be against the grain or something kind of controversial, if you will, from a taste point of view?
I don't think it wouldn't be controversial to say Jerry is the least funny of the four principals, right? Like everybody kind of thinks that, right? Or is that controversial?
No, I mean, listen.
Yeah, not be funny. He does do that. Am I funny now?
I just think.
No, yeah, at least funny. I think that's a fair point. It can be argued the other way, though. So I think it could be considered against the grain because, I mean, is he the least funny? He's definitely, O'Hara likes to say, what do you always say? He's the most consistent. Is that your line? Jerry's most consistent?
I think from season 1 through season 9, he's the most consistent. He stayed in character, if you will. And the other characters kind of had their ebbs and flows. And we prefer George overall. But as far as consistency, I think Jerry takes the cake.
But like, if you look at like great comedy duos, he's clearly the straight man, though. I know this.
Yes. Is really good. Yeah, for sure. I see your point there. Yeah, he's the straight man. He's not the funny guy. He's not getting the laugh. You know where he gets the laughs is with like almost like his stand up embedded into the show. His laughs are usually one liners that are like, you know, almost like jokes, not funny because of his acting or because of the premise or anything like that. If he is funny, it's usually because of that, like a sort of a one line or being the show.
No, but that's why the show's great. His unselfishness. It's like you letting Maggie get all the good laughs on your show. That's a great leader does that.
That's actually not by design. It's totally by accident. But No, I do think you hit on the head. Like, I think he put his ego to the side in a big way a lot of times. But his name was on the show though, so maybe that and the check certainly helped.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, I don't know. As you look back on you know, also too, I think the post Seinfeld career success that Julia Louis-Dreyfus had sort of makes her, puts her in a new category as far as funny people of all time. Because I don't think, if you're thinking of great comedic actors of all time, Jerry's definitely not on the list though, right? I mean.
Right. No, I agree with that. Yeah.
Yeah. That's fair. And that's not an insult really. I mean, right. But yeah, sort of against the grain. Oh my gosh. That's so hard to put me on the spot. I don't know. I feel like there's so many opinions that it's almost hard to go to against the grain because people do whatever they want with the show. Elaine was a good dancer. Elaine's dance was not as bad as everybody said.
We're not fans of that episode in general. So you're not against the group with us. Yeah, to our point, our overall arching point is the characters, like, we like cutesy. We like Elaine just being Elaine, you know, being, you know, there as the funny, you know, her little, what she's going to do in the Jimmy or something like this, right? We don't need her, I don't know, dancing around Pute de Mayo with her little outfit on. Yes, man. You know, like,
Andrew, the vibe I'm getting is you're like a later Seinfeld guy. The later seasons, Little Kicks, Brody. Okay.
Yeah. No, I got to be honest. Like, I recently saw an episode, the mayoral election with Giuliani. And the yogurt episode. That's like season three?
Season five.
That episode was unbelievable. Okay. Oh, yeah. I'm a season five. I'm like pure... 4, 5, 6, I think.
All right. Redeeming yourself here. But yeah, no. we had the original Lloyd Braun on the program. He's a friend of the show.
Yeah, it sounds like, I mean, when you're talking 4, 5, and 6, I mean, that's the heart of the show. That's prime time. If you look at it from like a sports perspective, I like to say like season one is like, you know, get called up in September and kind of show what you got. And then season two, you're winning Rookie of the Year. You know, season three, you're winning MVP. 4, 5, you're, you know, triple crown MVP, Hall of Famer. And then 6, you're still solid. 7, you're coming off the bench. You're making some big hits. And 8, 9, you're just kind of a journeyman. You're kind of just, you have your pops here and there where you win a game and a home run off the bench or something. But I don't know.
But is it every, like you just described the arc of pretty much every great show, right?
Fair. That's fair. That's why O'Hara's point is if they ended at the opposite, it would have been an all-timer. But I, for one, agree with him on a critical standpoint, but the show would have never gotten the legs it got or the admiration it got without those later seasons. That's when everyone was watching. You know, they heard about the other episodes and they chimed in later on and it got all the ratings and everything.
Can I ask a question? That was the end of the 5th season, the opposite. What was the first episode of the 6th season?
The Chaperone, which isn't a great episode, but then you get the Big Salad, which is good. Season 6 is solid. It's solid. It's good. It's solid. You got the Big Salad. You got the Chinese Woman. You got the Soup, the one you mentioned, which is a great episode, the Soup. The Secretary's in that one. The Race is in that one. The Doorman, the Jimmy. I mean, season 6 is solid.
When's Soup Nazi?
Now you're getting into 7. Yeah.
So, well, I mean, that's iconic, and that's 7.
It's iconic, yes. But again, definitions of iconic, you know, it got big splashy, but again, it was like kitschy catchphrase. Again, it kind of just got away from the core that we appreciated and watched live. And we get it. There's a huge following for it and people think it's so New York and blah, blah,
and
blah.
And like anything else, there's good in the bad episodes, right? Like you mentioned Little Kicks. I don't like Elaine kicking, but I love Brody. Like you said, Brody, like Brody's great. Brody with Jerry is great. That whole
thing. Yeah.
That's the same episode, right? I hate the Little Kicks, but I love Brody. But you don't
get wait, that. what about the Summer of George that I mentioned? That's pretty late too. When I love the what's the Jerk Store episode? I feel like that's towards the end too. And that's all time.
That's season 8, the comeback is season 8.
That little subplot with George and like when and the Jerk Store. I mean, I've heard a lot of people talk about that one too. I feel like I'm glad they kept.
Yeah,
going.
But that's written by Andy Robb and Greg Cavett, who are leftover from the earlier years. So they kind of have a gem kind of sprinkled in there.
That makes sense.
Listen, Seinfeld, and you know. Similar to like sports debates, I don't know, LeBron, Jordan. Like when you watch a guy live, it's different. than seeing these kind of these up and comers. But
wow,
is basketball, is that your main jam?
No, I actually, it's NFL for a long time. So I started out doing some NBA stuff. Then I got a job. It's a long story, working for the NFL for 3 years, and I did their in-house like Sunday ticket pre-game show and post-game show. I was a writer producer. Spencer Turner. So anyway, I got really into the NFL. Then I got a job as the NFL editor at SI.com. So I did almost all NFL for a long time. Now, basketball is my favorite sport to play. So now I do like a combo. Like our show, like any show, like you really have to talk as much football as you can because it reaches the biggest audience, pro and college. And then the next thing you can talk about is NBA, which I happen to love. But you can't do much baseball because baseball is big region by region, but it's not big nationally. And you can't do much hockey either. So I really like, I'd say NFL is my primary sport and then NBA.
So who's your, are you a Vasekahema Jaws guy? Who's your Eagle?
Randall Cunningham for life. Vasekahema was a great local newsman. Yeah. So yeah, Randall, me and my friends just love Randall. Like Jaws is an icon, and he's like, you know, he's established. But Randall was like in high school, at the peak of my football years, when Buddy Ryan was there, that was all Randall Cunningham. He's my favorite. Brian Dawkins and him are my two favorite Eagles of all time.
Seth Joyner. I love Seth Joyner.
We used to have the Joyner watch in the newspaper. Remember that? The Joyner watch.
He was so underrated. It was unbelievable.
Remember that Monday night game where he basically almost made the Hall of Fame in one night? I don't know. It was against the Oilers. It's a famous Philly game.
Yeah.
If you ever got the YouTube back, it is like a total domination. But Brian Dawkins, I don't know if you guys are, you might be Giants fans, but Brian,
there's a special, fan,
oh God, there's special pride in Philadelphia for Brian Dawkins. We joked the other day, like, if you can wear two things to your own wedding, a tuxedo or a Dawkins jersey, and nobody will give you a hard time. Because he was just like the gritty, hard-nosed guy. So everyone loved him.
Yeah, well, number 20, right?
Yeah, 20. 20. Yeah, exactly.
So how are things going? I mean, give us an obviously Maggie's a great partner. We know we're obviously from the fan here in New York, but and she's a big Seinfeld fan. I'm like, do you guys, obviously you got good chemistry. Do you talk Seinfeld a lot off air, on air? I'm just curious about that.
You know, no, we don't do a ton of Seinfeld on air. You know, the weird thing is, and like, to be totally honest, like some of like, we try to keep it like, some, we think some of our audience is too young to get the Seinfeld references, maybe. So we don't like, you know, we worry that our references are out of touch with the widespread audience. So we don't put a ton of cultural stuff, you know. Like, we try and do, like, the shows are on right now. And, like, of course we reference Seinfeld. Like, the other day, I think we said a line from Seinfeld. Like, something like, they're spectacular or something like that we know. But we have to be really cognizant of the fact that a big chunk of our audience might not have access to that. Also, too, think of where our audience is. Like, it's not just New York City. Like, we're bigger in the West Coast, the middle of the country. So, I don't know. No, to be honest, like, we don't sprinkle really as much Seinfeld as we probably should. So we try and talk a lot about like current shows. Like, we actually make a point. That might be a stupid philosophy. What do you think of that, guys? Like, honestly, like, we try and keep it like, why are we talking about, we should be talking about Squid Games, not a show that was big in 1998.
Well, you know your audience more, but I would say, generally speaking, I'm a fan, and even Seinfeld's a fan of this, the show, I think, in fact. That they, I've heard Larry David talk about this. Like, you give a reference, and if they don't get it, that's kind of them. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, you almost give the reference for you to kind of, like you said, you and Maggie bantering, and also for the people that do get it. And then the ones that don't get it, it's just like they're not gonna tune out because they don't get a reference. Maybe they'll even look it up or be like, what was that? And like that kind of thing. So I don't know. I mean, but you know your audience obviously. But I think like there's a fine line there of like. Like, because Seinfeld, talking about Seinfeld, they would throw in references when I'm watching it. I didn't get them at some point, right? Like, you know, James Mansfield. Maybe I didn't know the heck that was when I was 14 years old, right? But they throw it in there or like, you know, like they would use these references and like they're still funny, even though you don't 100% get them, you know, something like that.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I
Yeah.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, I'll just say like, and you guys do this well, it's just about being authentic. Like, whatever that is, like, the audience will come, you know?
Well, let me, you know, my answer to that question is, we started our show on CBS Sports Radio, CBS Sports Network, January 3rd. And I had come off the Dan Patrick Show, where in many ways I was riding Dan's coattails, and Maggie was on FAN with this big New York audience. So at first, I think we were afraid to be ourselves a little bit at first. We were trying to be, and I think in the 6 months, if you look at the last 3 months, we become more comfortable being authentic. I gotta tell you, like, I know, and that's not to say like the first 3 months were bad, but we're doing much more of our own things to make us laugh lately than at first. And you know what? I regret that a little bit, but like, we were trying to find our feet and our audience a little bit. And then, but I agree with you guys completely. If it's funny to us, that's all that matters, because you can't try to be funny for other people. But it took a matter of, like, we know each other pretty well. We were at SI, but it takes a while to get comfortable in a new show to be able to talk about it. So I think we've become more, every week we've become more authentic. And we have more, the other thing too is you build a little bit of a language of the show where people know what to expect and we can talk to each other. And so we're getting much better at that, I think.
Yeah, I mean, listen, the duo here in New York that you're probably familiar with, Mike and the Mad Dog, they were talking, you know, movies and ratings and just stuff that they enjoy talking about. But for my money, I'm taking you, Andrew, over Frances's scene in the Sandler movie. 100%.
Frances, you know, it's funny. So CBS Sports Radio, you know, it shares a hall with WFAN. And there's like the Mike Francesa break room. So I come from Philadelphia, which is Angelo Cataldi territory. Everyone knows Angelo. Nobody knows Mike and the Mad Dog, couldn't be farther away. So everybody has this like reverence for Mike and the Mad Dog. And I don't get it, because I just didn't grow up with it. But I mean, I do get it. Those guys are super entertaining. But it is like, I'm like in the shrine to Francesa and Russo and Steve Summers and all these FAN characters. Yeah, and it's weird.
We're big Steve Summers. We talked to Steve Summers. We're huge Steve Summers fans, so that was great that we got to talk to him. But
He's a legend.
I mean, you guys are, I think, like you said, you guys are doing great. I mean, the rapport you guys have with Maggie, it's really fun, you know. And I think, like you said, just be yourself, and it's awesome to see, you know, what you guys are doing over there. You know, I just to kind of get back to Seinfeld a little bit here, you know, in the last few minutes we have, I don't want to keep it too late, but curious, like, you know, you talked about the Buhner line, and you've also mentioned like a few other lines here and there, but like, to us, like, there's like the, you know, was that wrong, or you know, Cartwright and the Chinese restaurant you talked about, right? So like, are there lines that you do go to, like, my wallet's gone, or tippy toe lemon tree, like, all these things just pop into our heads all the time, constantly, like I'll say them to my kids, right? I don't even, like, they'll just, like, they're learning these lines. Like, do you do that in your kind of almost your everyday life, or not professionally, just like randomly, like, is there some, you know, go-to lines where you're just like, oh, that's a Seinfeld episode, I'm just gonna say it. Like, that's that, you know, it pops up, I don't know, it's kind of on the spot, but anything like that?
Yeah, no, you know, it's funny, it's not really the lines, it's more the scenarios where, like, we'll be in a pre-show meeting. This will happen with Dan Patrick all the time, because we love doing like cultural things, and we'd be describing an awkward situation, and like, everybody would be like, oh, you mean like the Seinfeld episode? And Dan would be like, Seinfeld did an episode on that? So it was more like situations, like, especially when I was single. I mean, I'm telling you guys, like, I was there in New York in the 90s. This was my life. So I'm sorry, like, that, none of really popping to mind, but we would do that all the time. It's more like, this is a Seinfeld scenario, like right. Shrinkage or something. Or, there's just so many, things. I think of the dating life, that was like, I kind of like, we aspired to be Seinfeld, where he always had a new pretty girlfriend in every episode. It's just like, but everything about it was just like so true to life. And I'm glad you said that thing about like that they wanted real stories, because that really, I actually didn't know that. I thought a lot of it was in their heads, but that explains a lot to me, because it really felt real to me. So yeah, I don't have, yes, all the time. Like, I'm sorry I'm blanking now, but all the time I'll be like, oh my God, I know that situation happened in Seinfeld.
Yeah, and to your point, New York in the early 90s, much different than like the New York we know today, although maybe it's getting back to that. But there was just like a kind of an edge and comedic even darkness to it. So that's interesting that you picked up on it as well for Seinfeld. But
I mean, by the way, like my New York comedy scene, like I was also big in stand-up in the 90s. And like, I don't know if you ever heard of Luna Lounge. And
I would watch. Yeah, like the alternative kind of people got their start a lot, right?
Yeah, so I was like a big Todd Barry fan and a Marc Maron fan and Janine Garofalo. So I was really into trying to see live comedy too. I mean, listen, like Seinfeld, the show, and Simpsons was huge for me. So I was a big comedy fan. And then a lot of people I know started performing at Upright Citizen Brigade or The Pit. Oh, yeah. So there was a lot of live comedy too, which I think is really different than Seinfeld, that underground scene. Kind of alternative. I think Seinfeld was the mainstream comic. But I think that there was Seinfeld going on, and then that spurned like a more like sort of a darker, like the Sklar Brothers. I'm just trying to think of all the
right.
A lot of that came out of that era of New York. And so because I lived on the Upper East Side, then I moved downtown. I lived downtown in Brooklyn for a long time.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
It's interesting you just mentioned that, because we had Mark Hirschfeld on, the casting director, and he said he used to go to these clubs in New York all the time, and that's how Patton Oswalt got the gig on Seinfeld. Sarah Silverman got the gig on Seinfeld because of that.
Yeah.
But yeah, I could see that scene. It does intertwine with Seinfeld, like in a way.
Yeah, you know? I saw Sarah Silverman all the time perform downtown. She was awesome. Yeah, that's really cool. I love I think it's underestimated like. What Seinfeld really spurned the live comedy thing. I was a big fan. A lot of amazing geniuses came through New York in the 90s. It's an incredible time.
Yeah, I mean, listen, Seinfeld was a comedic genius, an all-time show. The chemistry with Jerry and Elaine, we see that with you and Maggie. And listen, we wish you guys the best of luck. I know you're just getting started, but thanks so much for the time, Andrew. And Seinfeld on the show. I think
throw it in there. I think you'd be surprised.
No, you guys are seriously, you guys have like kind of made me rethink of it a little bit. Because of course that's who I am. I mean, like, all right. Yeah, I will. And tomorrow, I guarantee I will get in a solid Seinfeld reference tomorrow, and it'll be organic to the show, and I'll have a sports hook. It's gonna be perfect.
Thank you so much, Andrew. This was awesome.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Appreciate it, guys. I really appreciate it. Thanks a lot.
Have a great night.
Okay, good night. Thanks, guys.